So grateful for Eileen's beautiful music this morning. It was wonderful. Earlier this year, back in January, we invited Reverend Paul Davis, one of the ministers at the Congregational United Church of Christ in Greensboro, to visit us as a guest preacher. He spoke about his church's experience with becoming a sanctuary church and offering sanctuary to two individuals from Latin America. Before he came, he and I communicated with each other. He asked me, "Tom, what do you hope I will talk about?" And I shared with him a number of thoughts and suggestions and even a couple of questions that he might answer. And one question I posed to him that I thought was a rather good question was, "How has the work of sanctuary impacted you spiritually?" So back in January, Reverend Davis came to speak and stood in the pulpit and rebuked this question. He said, "Tom asked me to speak about how being involved in sanctuary has affected me spiritually, but I'm not interested in spirituality. I'm minister of a church. I'm not a very spiritual person. I'm a minister." It was kind of a stunning line, isn't it? And it was actually those words that planted the seed for this morning's sermon. We might imagine religion and spirituality as two partially overlapping circles forming a Venn diagram. The area where the two circles overlap would include people who consider themselves to be both spiritual and religious, but the circles don't completely overlap. There are people who think of themselves as spiritual but not religious, and there are people who think of themselves as religious but not spiritual, which I suspect is how Reverend Davis would probably identify himself. And then outside of both of those circles, there are people who think of themselves as neither spiritual nor religious. But this morning, I want to talk about just one of those overlapping circles. This morning, I want to talk about spirituality. And in my sermon this morning, I'm going to share with you my understanding of what spirituality is. I'm going to touch on both spiritual experience and spiritual practice. But I also want to have this conversation within a particular context, which is the context of our community, our congregation. Our community includes some people who think of themselves as quite spiritual, who are interested in spirituality, who intentionally seek out experiences of a spiritual nature, who carefully cultivate practices on a weekly or even a daily basis intended to expand their sense of the spiritual. And our community also includes some people who are not interested in spirituality at all and even chafe when there is too much of an emphasis on all that spiritual stuff. And of course, between these two poles, there are a lot of people in the middle, people who like a little spirituality, as long as it's not too much. And then there's also those whose place on this spectrum, if we can imagine a spectrum between the two, their place on the spectrum is not fixed, but changing. There are those who used to be uninterested in spirituality until they had a spiritual experience, and now they're trying to figure that out. And that there are those who are deeply desire a sense of spirituality, but are experiencing a dry spell, are feeling cut off from that sense of connection. I believe this is one of the healthiest forms of diversity that we embody as a community. We're a community that includes a spectrum from the extremely spiritual to the extremely non-spiritual and all points in between. So to Paul Davis's words, "I'm not a very spiritual person, I'm a minister," I would say that what I actually cherish about ministry here is getting to be in community with people who are enthusiastic about spirituality and with people who are suspicious rightfully suspicious of, or just not interested in spirituality at all. I enjoy it, and it makes for interesting work. If you've been counting, which you, I don't expect that you have been, I've used the word spiritual 28 times in the sermon so far. And I would bet that some of you are growing a bit frustrated, hoping that I will define what I mean or explain what I mean by this word. Unfortunately, I'm going to do that, but unfortunately it is a word that defies easy definition. Actually, I believe it's a word that resists easy definition, and here's why. The word spiritual comes from the Latin word spirare, meaning to breathe. Related words in English include respire, inspire, aspire, and perspire. But spirit means to breathe. It is linked with breath. If you have breathing problems, doctors may use a spirometer to measure not your spirit, but your lung capacity. In Greek, the word for spirit is pneuma. Pneuma means breath. Think of pneumonia. Think of pneumatic nail guns that use air pressure. I actually came and practiced that noise. Think of those old pneumatic tubes. Remember those where you can send something from one part of a building to another by putting it in this air pressure-filled tube and it gets sucked from one part of the building to the other? Remember those?
Yeah.
Spirit tubes. And in Hebrew, the word for spirit is ruach. Ruach is also the word for breath and also wind. Does anyone see a pattern emerging here? In Genesis, it is said that after God formed Adam out of dust, God gives Adam breath, ruach hakodesh, the spirit of God, and also the breath of God. Spirare, pneuma, ruach, spirit, breath, wind. I think this helps us to understand why it's such a hard idea to pin down definitely, to define what is spiritual, because it's fleeting, like breath. It's uncontainable and uncontrollable. And it's no wonder that so many spiritual practices begin by asking us to be attentive to our breathing. When I breathe in peace. When I breathe out love. Meditation, yoga, other spiritual practices ask us to pay attention to our breathing. There's this link between spirit and breath. And I want to spend just a second more here emphasizing this point, that there is an element to spirituality, especially spiritual and mystical experiences, that is wild and chaotic. Comes like this blowing wind around, like this draft that comes into your house even when you think all the windows are shut. In the Gospel of John, it's written, and I like the King James translation of this verse, "The wind bloweth where it listeth, and thou hearest the sound thereof, but canst not tell whence it cometh, and whether it goeth, so is everyone born of the Spirit." Or take this plain language translation of the passage. "You know well enough how the wind blows this way and that. You hear it rustling through the trees, but you have no idea where it comes from or where it's headed next. That's just how the Spirit works." I like that translation. That's just how the Spirit works. And that's how spirituality is. My imperfect definition of spirituality is this. I think spirituality is a way of cultivating thinking, feeling, and being that moves us away from conventional ways of thinking and our usual habits and directs us instead towards ways of thinking and behaving that we identify as more significant and more meaningful. That's just my definition, so don't pay that much attention to it, but I'll say it again. Spirituality is a way of cultivating thinking, feeling, and being that takes us away from conventional ways of thinking and our usual habits, and directs us towards ways of thinking and behaving that we identify as more significant and meaningful. That's my working definition of spirituality, and I want to point out a couple things about this definition. First, according to this definition, spirituality is neither inherently good nor inherently bad, because it can be both. Spirituality can be harmful or helpful, destructive or constructive. Though healthy spirituality helps us to cultivate ways of thinking, feeling, and being that lead to greater connection, greater awareness, greater self-awareness, and greater virtues, including awe, gratitude, wonder, courage, compassion, perseverance, forgiveness, and love, just to name a few. That's what healthy spirituality looks like, but there are forms of spirituality that are not healthy. Just as we know that there are forms of religion that are harmful, we know that fundamentalism, whether that's Christian or Jewish or Muslim, whether it's Hindu or Buddhist, and yes, there is such a thing as Buddhist fundamentalism, we know that just as those forms of religion engender exclusion and intolerance and violence, so too can some spiritual practices and experience themselves be unhealthy. You can give all sorts of examples, but just one that came to mind is that in much of neo-pagan spiritual practice, that there is this beautiful and life-affirming and wondrous healthy spirituality in it. There's also forms that are used to promote ultranationalism and racial supremacism, just as there are probably spiritual practices in any tradition. Another, though less extreme, version of harmful spirituality can be found in what is called spiritual bypassing. The literature defines spiritual bypassing as the tendency to use spiritual ideas and practices to sidestep or avoid unresolved emotional issues and unfinished developmental tasks. And the literature on this is fascinating, that spiritual practices actually don't kind of help us to get unstuck, but kind of keep us stuck where we are. That's another sermon entirely. The other thing about my definition is that it makes spirituality available to theists and non-theists alike. You do not have to believe that there is a spirit to be spiritual. Here's what Carl Sagan wrote about spirituality. He says, "Science is not only compatible with spirituality, it is a profound source of spirituality. When we recognize our place in an immensity of light years and in the passage of ages, when we grasp the intricacy, beauty, and subtlety of life, then that soaring feeling, that sense of elation and humility combined, is surely spiritual." He continues, "So are our emotions in the presence of great art, or music, or literature, or acts of exemplary selfless courage, such as those of Gandhi or Martin Luther King." Sagan concludes, "The notion that science and spirituality are somehow mutually exclusive does a disservice to both." A friend of mine defines spirituality this way. He says, "Spirituality is an intentional and practiced meaningful relationship with the biggest reality possible. And for some people, the biggest reality possible is God. For others, the biggest possible reality is a universe about 13.8 billion years old, containing around 100 billion galaxies, so that's a conservative estimate. That one of those 100 billion galaxies, ours, contains 250 billion stars. And that around one of those stars, there is a planet on which life came into being out of a chemical stew nearly 4 billion years ago and evolved since into millions of species of plants and animals, including one that has developed the capacity to figure out that this all happened. I can be sarcastic, I would say, there's nothing spiritual there at all. So my point is that it's the easiest definition, I think, for spiritual, the easiest and probably imperfect definition is that which makes us gasp and need to re-catch our breath. That we don't have to believe that there is some spirit in the wind. I think all we need to do is breathe. So I wonder why it is that Reverend Davis and came to kind of stand here and reject spirituality. And I think that there are myths and misunderstandings of spirituality that are widespread and perhaps even contain an element of the truth, but don't contain the whole truth. And I'd like to address a couple of those. The first myth is that spirituality is self-absorbed. At the Temple of Delphi in ancient Greece, there was a holy stone known as an omphalos. Omphalos is Greek for belly button. And it was thought to be the belly button of the world, the place of connection with the realm of the gods. And in several world religions, including Eastern Orthodox Christianity and in Hinduism, omphaloskepsis is advised as a meditation technique. We're going to learn a new word this morning. Omphaloskepsis, which means literally the contemplation of one's belly button. I'm serious. There is actually in Eastern Orthodox, in some forms of yoga, there is a spiritual practice that one begins with the contemplation of one's belly button. Rival monks made fun of them for this, and thus was born the term navel gazing. There are probably forms of spiritual practice that are self-absorbed to a fault, but then again, I have no proof of it, but I do know that Gandhi practiced yoga, and that in some forms of yoga, there's a form of meditation in which one does contemplate one's navel. So it's wholly possible, perhaps even likely, that Gandhi meditated on his own belly button, and yet we would think of Gandhi as the farthest thing from self-absorbed. So that's one kind of myth, is that spiritual practice is all about self-absorption. And I think that there is another that I touched on earlier, which is that spirituality requires us to believe in God or spirit or deity. And I don't think that's necessary. I believe that it's fully possible to have experiences and call them spiritual even without a belief in a higher power or being. The spiritual practices in which I engage are first and foremost the regular reading of poetry. It's probably my most developed spiritual practice, which I do daily or, to tell you the truth, almost daily. I attempt to do it daily. And I find that the reading of poetry brings an expansive vision, helps me to notice details, helps me to see the connections between things, helps me to feel more connected. And appreciation of nature, like many Unitarian Universalists, I experience a spiritual connection to nature. It's an experience that I describe as spiritual, and again, it helps me with paying attention, with noticing, and also crossing that boundary sort of beyond myself, realizing my own place in the scheme of things. In conclusion, this morning, I invite you to just think about these words and how they contrast and compare with your own idea of spirituality. My goal is to get you to be spiritual or get you not to be spiritual. You're fine the way you are. But as you know, also know, the Spirit bloweth where it listeth. And there is always the opportunity for surprise. Amen. Blessed be. Thank you. And we're going to end with one of my favorite songs about a sense of spirituality, and it's a nature spirituality that's described in the hymn. It's the beautiful hymn number 4, our closing hymn, I Brought My Spirit to the Sea.